Well, thanks a lot for staying with us here on Sunrise Live on E as we continue with the conversations on this Friday morning. Now, with the introduction of a new labor federation, the South African Federation of Trade Unions, or rather SAFTU, it begs to question exactly what happens now when it comes to trade union. What is it that is going to make them different? And also, what is the role of COSATU in all of this, especially when it comes to the representation of the people? The people continue to fight for their rights, and obviously unions are under immense pressure to perform, as well as to stick to their promises of really being the representatives of those who are in the labor market and those who are interested in joining the labor market. So joining us in studio this morning really to discuss this matter further about the relevance of trade unions, as you would appreciate that May Day is just around the corner, we do have joining us the Gauteng Provincial Secretary of COSATU, Dumisani, Dakile, as well as the Deputy General Secretary of SAFTU, Moleko Phakedi. And of course, we invite you as always to be part of our conversation at home. Remember that number to dial is 011-447-1742, alternatively 1620. And also do feel free to leave your comments on our Facebook as well as our Twitter pages. Gentlemen, thank you so much to the both of you for joining us this morning.
Good morning to you and to the viewers.
Well, Dumisani, perhaps we should start off with you. We saw that during the week it was all about the newly launched federation, that is SAFTU. As COSATU, what was your response to that launch? I mean, obviously you witnessed it.
Well, basically we must understand the fact that we have been fighting ever since our establishment for the rights of each and every individual to have a freedom of association, for people to form their own political parties, for people also to form trade unions, and also for people to be able to form federations of trade unions. So those has been basically what we've been fighting for as an entrenched. I mean, we've managed to fight that. Many of our members sacrificed their lives for that. As we speak, some of them even went to jail for that particular right. So I don't think that COSATU can have a qualm if people associate themselves and they come together and form trade unions.
Do you think that they were on a winning streak? Do you think that they will actually succeed in getting the people's representation, especially with regards to Zweli Zimavavu was actually on our seat in the beginning. I think it was last week, Friday. You would appreciate that one. And he was speaking about how COSATU's time has come to an end.
Well, I don't think that is correct. I mean, there have been other many unions that have been formed after COSATU. We have what we call today FEDUSA, which was formed after COSATU. And they were all halabaloos about COSATU that is going to diminish. COSATU is still in existence today. We have NACTU that has been formed, and all halabaloos were said about it. COSATU is still in existence today. We have what was called CONSAU, which we don't know what happened with it today.
So basically what you're saying to Dumisani is that talk is cheap until you see the actual results in itself. And I want to bring Moleko into this conversation there as well. You witnessed when it came to the words that were sent, or the sentiments that were shared by Zweli Zimavavi regarding the future of COSATU and how SAFTU is going to be rising up as that representative of the people.
Well, thanks, Faith, and good morning to you and your viewers. I mean, COSATU must be honest to itself. The reality is that it has not been able to bring about representation of about 76% of workers who remain outside the union setups. And as a result thereof, it has also been caught in some serious quagmire over the recent period of time. It has not been able to exercise its independence as a federation to drive its programs, implement its resolutions. It is quite compromised with its arrangement with the alliance. So to say, so Zweli Zimavavi was quite correct. I mean, if things are going to go as they are with the rise of SAFTU, that set the demise of...
Do you think
that
they're intimidated by you? COSATU, that is.
I believe
so. I mean,
so.
Dumisani is sitting right next to you, and it seems quite comfortable in your existence, but do you think that they actually are intimidated by the fact that numbers are saying, and we don't necessarily know until they're on paper, but numbers are saying that about 700,000 individuals will be part, or members will be part of SAFTU.
We have launched a very successful, we had a very successful national launch congress during the previous week. And the response we have got, I mean, from workers themselves, from members of those 22 unions who were there, is quite positive. That indeed, a true representative of workers in the form of SAFTU have on our horizon. And as a result thereof, There is no need for workers to feel in any way homeless, so to say. Mm. The crisis that COSATU has had over the past period of time, and is still continuing to have, and it will continue to have, will give rise to growth of SAFTU. Nonetheless, SAFTU is going to grow outside outside the organized workers, because there are about 76% of workers that are not necessarily organized under any trade union. So SAFTU was quite correct in its launch congress that primarily is to ensure that workers who are not under any trade unions are organized.
And that is 76% of workers.
Of workers.
So do we understand that as much as, and what I'm trying to avoid here is us having a very intellectual conversation about matters where we're not getting to the root cause of it and we're politicizing everything. The fact of the matter is, if 76% of workers are not represented by a union, I'm going to ask you now, what's your relevance? Why are you even here? Before we knew and understand, and history in itself points to the representation of those workers who can't stand up for themselves. But if 76% of those are not part of a trade union, then what are you doing, guys, as trade unions, Dumisani?
I think the point that we must be able to raise is the fact that the rise of SAFTU, for example, has not changed the balance of forces on the ground, precisely because you still remain with the 76% of the workers that still remain unorganized.
But isn't that a problem for you? I mean, to say those figures, and you're a trade union, may I just say, to say those figures and you're a trade union, from my understanding, trade unions represent the plight of the workers. You shouldn't be proud of those figures. 76% of what I should be in a trade union. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, if 76 of those workers are not under a trade union, surely we can't be saying that with pride.
I think that's why I'm saying just afford us an opportunity to be able to explain. And one example that I was going to cite is in terms of that what you call your white collar workers. And in the South African context, for example, majority of what is called your white collar workers are white workers who probably, in a way, the system of capitalism and apartheid ideology has indoctrinated them for them not to be able to see a need for them to be able to join trade unions.
So basically, secondly, it's apartheid's fault that white-collared workers, or can I call them professionals, right? So white-collared workers or professionals, as you would call them, are not part of trade unions. It's as a result of the indoctrination of the apartheid regime.
That's one factor. This thing is composed of many factors. Secondly, we have what we call our own black brothers, colored what you call workers, and Indian workers, who probably perceive themselves as a middle class, and also in terms of the role that they play as managers and what they've been as professional, they don't necessarily have a conscience of themselves as workers.
And they don't have so it's the workers' fault because they don't have a conscience of themselves.
Well, precisely because in terms of how they see themselves, they see themselves as probably the owners of,
so do you think
of,
that they've also
of the
been
means of production.
Do you think that they also have been indoctrinated by the system of apartheid?
Well, that's our history of apartheid, it's our history of colonialism. You've got plenty of managers, for example, who don't necessarily, some of them have been members of the union. Once they cross the fire and take up responsibilities, some of the conditions that have been told, in order for you to be able to sustain your position, in order for you to be able to sustain your salary, it simply means you can't associate yourselves with trade unions. In fact, some of the indoctrination, it goes to an extent that they even begin to hate trade unions, which has even enabled them, for example, to become managers.
Do you agree with this? May I ask, Moleko?
No, you know, we need to be a bit frank with the reality of the situation. The crisis of representation is coming as a result of lack of unions, as probably they have existed and they may have existed, to take up workers' issues and struggles, advance that without fear or favor or, for that matter, prejudice. And as a result thereof, the close proximity of COSATU to the ruling party, its close proximity to government, have now compromised COSATU's ability to drive campaigns.
So
and
you're saying that it's not as a result of apartheid indoctrination?
The South African constitution is quite clear, it guarantees workers' rights. For that matter, the Labour Relations Act has clearly covered the issues of workers' rights insofar as joining trade union existing and workers practicing their rights. So that particular aspect is to an extent covered. Trade unions have existed during the apartheid system in South Africa. It's not that recently that you've got trade unions. Trade unions were very militant then. We're campaigning, we're dealing with workers' issues under a difficult apartheid system. What then would be the reason post 94 that workers would not necessarily be active in trade unions. Therefore, then give rise to what is the exact purpose of existence of trade union? To deal primarily with workers' issues, bread and butter issues. Of course, we cannot be divorced from political issues. We cannot be divorced from societal issues. But we need to strike the perfect balance. We are a trade union. We represent workers and members of trade union in various sectors of the economy, and we should be able to advance that. I mean, COSATU, Dumisani will agree with me. At some point, went to an extent of telling his own province not to take up a campaign on labor broker, a campaign on e-tolls. It was a sore reality that they had to go through. What does that mean to
Why
ordinary workers? Because it was conveniently, in the sense that you were in the eve of elections, and the close proximity to the ANC would not necessarily have granted a great
atmosphere
for them to advance the issues of workers.
I want us to go into the issue of why. We actually had a conversation around the representatives or representing the workers' need. And you mentioned a very interesting point, Moleko, saying that it was Dumisani himself, when he was speaking to union members, that he actually said, and I want you to say this with me and correct me, that they shouldn't join the protest against e-tolls or the protest against labor brokers. Is that what you said?
No. What happened is that COSATU campaigns to drive around labor brokerage,
yes,
and e-tolls.
Mm-hmm.
His province, Gauteng province, being the biggest province then, in a central executive committee meeting, was advancing the implementation of that program. He had well-planned marches, mobilized workers.
Mm.
The federation at the central executive committee level told him in no uncertain terms that you are not going to drive that particular program.
Mm.
So my point is, if a trade union or a trade union federation is unable to deal with its own members' issues and interests,
even from the central perspective,
for political conveniency, mind you, it was on the eve of elections, if you can recall that, it then serves to bring you about your question.
So does that mean that you were muted, Dumisani, that you were put under pressure by the central executive, and then where you wanted to stand up for the workers, where you wanted to stand up for South Africans, and then you found yourself being muted by the powers of that be?
That is not correct. I think if we'll, let's take the question of the e-tolls, for example.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed, there's Gauteng who has been championing that particular struggle, and we still continue to champion that particular struggle. And I think we've made quite a very significant progress in that regard. Firstly, I think we should be able to understand that the e-tolling system was not only going to be in the current, roles only. It was supposed to be extended also to M1, it was supposed to be extended to M2, it was supposed to be extended to on what you call the road of N4.
Mm.
Because precisely because of those struggles, that particular those project are off the hook now.
Mm.
That there's not going to have any e-tolling that takes place. But over and above that, there have been processes that we've been engaged with, which among others have resulted in terms of a reduction of the fees. And
so is he, perhaps a question, let me put it to you this way. Is Moleko lying to us as the Republic of South Africa on this television show by saying that you got that instruction from the central executive to not go ahead with that campaign? Is this man sitting right beside me here lying to the people about that instruction?
I think he's misrepresenting the facts, because remember, in any campaigns that have been pursued, those campaigns are
misrepresenting the facts, is some form of representation of that?
No,
it's a hard reality that Dakile, my comrade, is struggling with. And he knows this very well. It was a pain to the leadership of Gauteng. I was in that central executive committee then.
So you were there?
Mind you, I'm from FAU. FAU was an affiliate of COSATU. I said in that executive, you were at pain, Dakile, trying to get the CEC to allow you to continue with the campaign. You were told in clear terms, you are not going to have that campaign few days before the actual planned campaign. It was not a plan. There was a date set, workers were mobilized, issues raised, rallied the community society around those issues. When it was supposed to be carried forward, it couldn't be carried forward. Ask him why.
Why?
The CEC told him in clear terms, you, Gauteng leadership, will not continue with that particular campaign. We were at pain as well as FAU, to the same extent as they were, because
let's
we believe that we shouldn't be able
to
compromise workers' issues.
He's saying that
for
you're misrepresenting it, so why?
It's not correct, Dakide.
The reason why, it was precisely because government has came, and including the ANC, to us and said, we think that there is a solution over this particular
So in other words, Moleko was not lying.
No. I'm saying that if you remember that if you engage on a strike, A strike is not a strategy, it's a tactic.
You're not answering and the question. You're being political with me, Dumisani. The only question I'm asking is, is he right, this man right here?
That's what I'm saying to you. Mm-hmm. I'm saying to you, you sometimes abandon an action at the last moment because mm-hmm. what you want to achieve, we have achieved it. You don't go on strike on an action for the sake of being counted that you have went on a strike. When your enemy says, in terms of what you want, we are able to concede on it on the following terms. Can we have an engagement in relation to that? We have therefore a discussion at the Central Executive Committee level that these have been developments that have taken place, and therefore there is a space for us to go and engage.
Let's tackle Sakile, because Sakile is standing up for those individuals that are working within the smaller businesses, as you would say. How does he find a solution to his problem?
No, Sakile is correct. Over a period of time, there have been new type or form of employment nature. Mm. Casualized, privatized, permanent fixed, labor brokers set up, casualization. That in a way has affected workers seriously in this sense. Workers have not been able to have job security. And as a result thereof, their ability to exercise their right to join trade union have to an extent been compromised. That's not an excuse. It also comes to how unions have responded to such issues. One, organizing those type of work has not been easy, but it's a necessary and a possible task that unions need to carry forward. We believe to the SAFTU that we need to be quite aggressive in that space, because that's where you find your young workers, that's where you find most of female workers who are not necessarily largely within trade union for reasons that I can advance. But the point that one is raised is that there is a new form of employment that have crept in, that have been some form of a threat to existing, secured, permanent, long-term basis kind of
So what must he do?
What he must do is to join a union. And I will tell him, go and join SAFTU unions. That will be able to drive about ensuring that you are permanently, directly employed, your rights, benefits are conferred. And for that matter, the Department of Labor must also do its work. They must ensure that the policy implementation and monitoring of enforcement of the legislation, because that's one issue that is raising.
Dumisani, I know that you want to say something regarding Sakile, but I also want to give us a gift and opportunity, and I'm just taking time into consideration here. Gift was making a point about COSATU, and clearly he was watching what has happened and unfolded on this table. So how then do you respond to members of COSATU who are saying that from where we are standing, you look quite compromised, number one, as a result of the political affiliation, but number two, because you're failing at answering the very crucial aspects that they need answers to?
I think the point of the matter that we have indicated, it is fallacy that we have abandoned the campaigns. We have been on the campaigns. As we speak, on the 20th, we're on the street for the whole day confronting monopoly capital. We marched to APSA. As we speak on May Day, we're also on the street. We are going to march to...
With these marchings, are you getting people jobs while they're marching, though? Here's the question.
That's the reason, because monopoly capital in South Africa, it is making huge profits and not investing back in terms of those particular profits to the economy, mm-hmm. creating in terms of what you call in the productive sector.
Question answered. Now answer the next part of compromise. Are you compromised? Because the perception is that you are compromised.
We are not what you call compromised.
So Gift has got the story wrong.
For example, on the 20th, last week on Thursday, we had convened massive shop steward council, where more than 3,000 of our shop stewards were in that particular meeting, where we came to communicate in terms of the decisions of the Central Executive Committee around the same issues that gives the
You look like
raising.
You want to dispute with that.
You know, I'm saying to you, who were there, I was there, I convened that particular meeting. I had more than 3,000 shop stewards that attended that particular meeting. We had a thorough discussion around the same issues. And overwhelmingly, in that particular shop steward council, the agreement has been reached to the fact that COSATU is correct in relation to its approach.
What would you say to that?
COSATU is seriously compromised, not you as a person, Daki. COSATU as an organization is compromised, ideologically, politically, and otherwise. Sdumo Dlamini is the president of COSATU. He subordinates the whole organization under a structure of its ally. I mean, he's an NEC member of the ANC. He subordinates COSATU as an organization, as a president of the organization under the South African Communist Party. He's a CC member. ANC, COSATU, SACP, they are going through a serious crisis. And the crisis is very simple, it's correct, it's class terms. Classes that are contradicting within COSATU, within the SACP and the ANC, in this case, capitalists have, the monopoly capitalists talking about, have captured the ANC thereby have captured the South African Communist Party, and equally COSATU. COSATU is unable to speak out on its own without necessarily conferring with the party or, for that matter, with the African National Congress on issues of interest to members of COSATU. That's compromised, so far as I'm concerned. The nature of COSATU as a trade union is changing. You are no longer a militant organization you want to be. You are no longer a campaigning federation you want to be. You have lost that long time ago. When you find the comfort of collaborating, cooperating with the Zuma administration for convenience sake. That's why they are confused as to who's going to address their May Day. Other affiliates says, says Zuma must address.
I just want to give him a space so that I'm able to
Zuma can't address that.
Are you confused with who's going to...
Contradictions are compromising confused. Your own organization.
We're not confused at all. We have never been confused. Mm-hmm. We are an independent
trade union. Who's addressing May Day then?
We've got the...
Who's addressing May Day, Dumisani?
It is many, many, many leaders.
Give me a name.
We've got 19 radis.
Ramaphosa.
We've got 19 radis.
Is it Sir Ramaphosa as President Jacob Zuma?
It is more than that. It is a...
I asked for one.
There is a national May Day.
I'm saying to you, I'm saying to you, we've got 19 May Day radis across the entire country. And you want me to state each and every May Day rally who's going to do it?